yours okay?
Oh, we have.
Oh, there we go.
Well, I was here last night.
Can you light better?
I've never used one before. Happy Saturday.
Shabbat shalom.
I'll do a little Q&A here. I've got some clips queued up, and then you can ask some questions.
Okay.
Yeah, so Paul, you were born in Omaha, and your father was an engineer. You moved around quite a bit.
I went to 9 schools by the time I was in the 9th grade. I mean, I was always the new kid in school. And I mean, like, when I was in about the 4th grade, I could still run under coffee tables. I was just a tiny little guy, you know. So I was always the new kid in school. I was always the littlest kid in school. And at the time, it seemed tough. I think what it was is a gift. I think that I learned to get along with people quickly. I learned to, if they were laughing and we were not fighting, there were a number of things you pick up from that. But it was a kind of a gypsy life, you know.
And when you were, what, about 8 or 9, you started getting hormone injections?
Yeah, I was so tiny, and my dad was like, this is really weird. He's 9, and he has a 3-year-old brother who's about to outgrow him. Maybe we should take him to a doctor, So they took me to a doctor in Albuquerque, New Mexico. He's a little country doctor, and he said, I can make it grow. He said, I'm going to give him some male hormone. So they gave me a male hormone, and it was the worst thing they could have done because it kicked me into puberty, which shuts off the bones and all. But it also has another effect. All of a sudden, I had no interest in my toy chest, but my Aunt Edna's chest was fascinating. I kept blocking things to get her to bend over and pick them up. And as my mother told me later, she said, "You, with all the little girls, you were saying, let's hide in the closet and kiss like they do in the movies. That cost me 2 marriages. That's how long that I wanted to, kiss like they do in the movies." I think that's perhaps, so they stopped with the shots. And when they stopped with the shots, of course, that whole hormonal thing that had activated was gone. And it was really, really slow returning. I didn't hit puberty until I was probably 22. So high school was, I remember being in the showers with a body that looked like it was made out of cantaloupe going, I don't care how big you make me, just cover me with fur. It was a tough time, but I survived it. And because of that slow aging process, I think I'm still experiencing it. I'm 83. Wow. And I jog 2.5 miles every morning. I work out 3 times a week. I joke that I feel like a tired 34. You know what? The big amigo has a plan, and whatever it was, it seems to be working out just fine. I couldn't be happier.
Yeah, everyone can turn off your cell phones, please.
Can you talk a little bit louder?
Yeah, please? If anyone could turn, everybody could turn off their cell phones, that'd be terrific. Yeah. So when you were 13, I think your father died, and then you moved to California.
Yeah, I was 13. My dad was killed in a car wreck. My dad was a sweet, drinking every night alcoholic. Both of my brothers, I had an older brother and a younger brother. All 3 of us became alcoholics. All 3 of us got sober. They're both gone. The only difference between the way we dealt with our addiction is that I quit smoking and they did not. And if you're a smoker, please God, stop. It took my older brother in his late 60s. It took my younger brother, who's a wonderful songwriter, at age 70. And it was all related to the smoking.
All right, so yes, you moved to California, and then you began to pursue a career in acting, which we'll play a clip here.
If it's the loved one, you'll see how young I looked at, there you go, 20, at like 22.
Hey, kid, don't go in there. There's a light bomb in there.
It isn't a bomb. Oh, it's a 20-centimeter projectile. I launched it approximately 0.500 hours. I keep tracking this for a marginal error in trajectory calculus.
All right, sign.
Retardation chute must have failed. Oh, overheated. Disintegration of thread fibers, light stabilizers. You okay? What time did it touch down?
What the hell do you mean, touchdown? You call that a touch?
It's very important that I know the time of touchdown.
Listen, kid, somebody's gonna pay for this hole in the roof.
Don't you have insurance?
You're the one who's gonna have to have insurance, Buster. What is that thing anyway?
It's a modified C7 Wildcat single stage 1H turbo with a 4G thrust.
It is, huh? Where'd you get it?
I floated.
When will I ever get a chance to take a selfie of myself at the ages 83 and 22? Wow. I have to say something, Jesse, about the clips that you put together. That, you know, I've been doing this a long time, and I speak a lot. I speak a lot about the creative process. I speak a lot about music creators' rights, and I speak a lot about recovery. I'm 33 years sober and really active in recovery. It's the best part of my life and all. I very seldom have experienced a series of clips that are as beautifully and lovingly put together as what you did. This guy's amazing. You can even give him a big hand.
What did you think of your co-star, Jonathan Winters?
Well, I love Jonathan Winters, and he, for years he was my neighbor. You know, I was an actor for, you know, very briefly, hard to cast. I did that movie, I did another movie a little bit later and all, but it's interesting with Jonathan, because about, oh, that was Snipes, 1963. Around 1967, I started writing songs, and by like 1970, I was fairly well known, but you know, as a songwriter, not on television, not at my, I wasn't out in the public a lot, but they were talking about Paul Williams, the songwriter, on the radio. So I went out, of course, and I bought a Model 35 Bugatti. I had this beautiful antique car, and one day I drove it to my business manager's, and I parked right in front of the office building where the business manager is. And who comes walking down the steps of my business manager? Was Jonathan Winters, and he looked at the car and he looked at me and he went, "Oh my God, you are that Paul Williams. I wonder what happened to you." We became really good friends. We, you know, first of all, in the movie, I followed him around like a puppy. I mean, I was just, he's the funniest, sweetest human being in the world, and crazy, you know. Incidentally, sober. He was not drinking from the time, you know, he had an incident in San Francisco where he was walking around pretending he had a hand grenade, saying, "Where's the toy department? Where's the toy department?" So he quit drinking. But we were neighbors in Montecito. I had a home in Montecito years later, and Jonathan Winters lived on one side of me, and Robert Mitchum lived on the other side. Gee, wow. And I was friends with both, and Robert Mitchum put me in rehab twice. You know. And Jonathan always sent me a Christmas card to occupant.
So in 1968, with Biff Rose, you wrote Fill Your Heart, which became the B-side for Tiny Tim's signature song, Tiptoed Through the Tulips.
And I did not want, I mean, you know what, I met Biff Rose on the Mort Salsa television show. We were improvisational actors, and we were both beginning songwriters. We wrote a couple songs together. He went to A&M Records, played them everything he'd ever written. They liked his songs, and they liked a couple that I had written as well. So he called me and he said, "You know, I told them that you wrote the lyrics to this one song, and they want to talk to you." It turns out they were looking for a lyricist from a guy named Roger Nichols, who was under contract there. So I went in, and the first, I had two songs recorded almost within like probably 2 weeks of signing with A&M Records. As a publishing, I signed not with a record company, but with a publishing company. I had a song called It's Hard to Say Goodbye, which was recorded by Claudine Leger. And then I had Tiny Tim recorded this song as a B-side of Tiptoe Through the Tulips. And I was like, I said, "I'm not thinking about Tiny recording one of my songs. He's a dear man and a sweet man." But you know, but what I didn't realize is that for every record that sells, and it was a million selling record, the B-side gets paid the same mechanical fee. And they got tired of playing his song on the radio, so they flipped it over and started playing my side too. So I had this great free ride, but I had something else happen that was a life lesson for me. Here I am going, "No, you got it wrong, universe. Why are you giving my song when I want to be a rock and roll writer?" when I want to write contemporary, why are you giving my song to Tiny Tim? Turns out that a guy that I liked and admired very much heard it and put it on his album. It was the first outside song that he ever recorded. The guy was David Bowie, and the album was Hunky Dory. He recorded Fill Your Heart, and I stopped questioning at that moment.
Yeah, my favorite Bowie album.
My philosophy was born. No is a gift. No is a gift.
And then in early 1970, you were approached to write a jingle for a TV commercial. Let's go here. She sings it, I think, a lot better than I do, even I have to. You know, what was interesting about this is that that was supposed to be a commercial written by a guy named Tony Asher. If you don't know who Tony Asher is, you've heard a lot of his music. He wrote the lyrics to God Only Knows What I'd Be Without You. He wrote a bunch of stuff with the Beach Boys and all. And see, he broke his hand skiing. So he said, he called Roger, he was friends with Roger, he said, you know, he said, I'm on pain pills, I broke the hand I write with, he said, I can't, I'm loopy. He said, so loopy made me think of you and Paul. And anyway, he said, I recommended the two of you to write this commercial, and I was like, I don't want to write a commercial, a bank commercial, I'm black, I mean, I'm like, white light, black leather, it's my usual thing about, but I'm going to be a rock and roll songwriter, which I never became a rock and roll songwriter. You know, that may have been the point on Horizon. I thought I was sailing to the Big Amigo had other plans. But anyway, Roger was like, let's write this. I said, no. He said, there's a creative fee. I said, let's write this. You know? And
And it was, you know, at the time, the number one album in the country was in a Gotta DeVita. There's no way in the world. You saw that little commercial. There's no way in the world that was going to be a hit song until an angel sang it. And Richard Carpenter saw the commercial, recognized my voice, asked Roger and I if there was a full song. But there was. If there hadn't been, we'd have written it that afternoon. And it was, we thought it was going to be an album cut, and it just went crazy. And all of a sudden, that recording by the Carpenters was, you know, it was probably the recording that changed my life and put us on the map. So great, so great.
Yeah, I was just talking to Paul yesterday. One of her biographies, Little Girl Blue, she had her doorbell programmed to play the first six notes that we've only just begun.
You know what was great too? They also, yeah, and I didn't know that, but what's cool is that when they signed with A&M Records as a recording artist, Herb Alpert and the head of publishing, Chuck Kay, brought him around to say hello. So I'm in the Rogers office with them. We've got offices at, you know, the opposite ends of an outdoor of a building, on one of the buildings on A&M Records. A&M Records, incidentally, is on the old Chaplin lot, the old Charlie Chaplin. So every now and then I'll see a Charlie Chaplin movie and I'll go, you see that window? That was my office. Not at the same time, but I'm not that old. But they brought him around to say hello. And nobody, I mean, Roger and I, everything Roger and I were writing got recorded. They were album cuts, they were B-sides. We were like, are we ever gonna hear anything on the radio? And the feeling at that time was between us was like, evidently not. We were making a really good living, but nobody outside of the business knew who we were. And so Chuck and Herb Alpert show up with these two kids and said, we'd like you to meet A&M's newest recording artist, Karen and Richard Carpenter. And they went like, oh, we love the Peppermint Trolley recording of Trust, and somebody else's recording of The Drifter, listed about five things in a row, and we were like, we're famous. Somebody actually knows who we are. So it was lovely to have them show up as fans. We became fans immediately. The first thing they recorded was a song called I Kept On Loving You, which was the B-side of Close to You. And the next one they did was We've Only Just Begun, then Rainy Days and Mondays, I Won't Last a Day Without You, Let Me Be the One. They were amazing for us, and I'm grateful every day. And I miss her every time I hear her voice. She was brilliant.
Yes, your music has touched people deeply. Most of your music deals with themes of loneliness and sadness. Rainy Days and Mondays, Let Me Be the One. Of course, loneliness, sad song. The Carpenters, Karen Carpenter, also had a lot of those feelings. Were these feelings that you experienced as a child and an adult?
I think they're feelings that we all experience. You know, it's like, sometimes, you know, being with somebody that you love more than anybody else in the world, you can sit there and go, like, how am I going to do the rest of this day with them, let alone? It's like, we're people. We have these, and we have the same set of emotions. I think my success is based on the fact I was never educated enough or sharp enough to be too sophisticated for people to get it, you know? When I say, you know, day after day I must face a world of strangers where I don't belong, I'm not that strong. I think a lot of people can go, yeah, I feel that way some days. I think that authenticity is massive to, let me tell a quick story about my brother if I can. My little brother was 6'2", his name was Metro Williams, and he wanted to be a songwriter, 6 years younger than me. And when I was pretty successful, I mean, really successful in the early 70s, he was going to school in Albuquerque. He was one of these guys who at 16 was singing in bars in Red River, New Mexico and all. And he came out, he's just a big old cowboy, and he wanted to write songs, and I got him a little 6-month deal at A&M Publishing. They gave him an office just down from mine. And for 6 months, he was listening to the radio, see what was going on, writing songs, and nothing. And nothing was happening. People weren't listening to him. In those days, you would put a dub, cut an acetate, a dub, have people listen to the dub, and they'd pick up the needle after the first verse. Nothing. And he's listening to the radio, trying to write what he thinks is going to be a hit, and nothing's happening. So Bingo, it's 6 months and the contract is over. So he goes into to A&M Records on a rainy Saturday. It's raining like a, you know, buckets. He goes up to his office, he sits down in his chair, he realizes he's got to take all the stuff off the walls, and the dream is not going to happen. He's just like, he's confused. What am I doing wrong? And he picks up a yellow pad and a paper and he writes, day after day, I'm more confused. He looks out and goes, you know, look for the light in the pouring rain. This has to come down. You know, that's a game I have to lose, hate to lose. But he had a big faith. I'm counting on you to carry me through. Give me the beat, boys, and free my soul. I want to get lost in your rock and roll and drift away. He wrote a song that is alive and well today. It's a rock and roll anthem. He produced it with Dobie Gray. He wrote from the center of his chest, not because he was smart, not because he was sharp, but because he was brave enough to write what he felt. There's a big lesson for there. Be your authentic self and watch the amygdala just put together the best life for you.